And I wanted from the start to make Blade 2 an absolute comic book movie.
There hadn't been a lot of good comic book movies made. There have been a lot of horrible films made. And I'm very proud of the fact that Blade is frequently cited as being one of the best comic book movies ever. And I think that the sequel, in almost every way, tops what we did in the first film.
Because when you read a comic book, you're never saying to yourself, oh, well, this is just all in good fun. You're entering into that universe. And that we're taking the exact same approach here.
And it gives us an opportunity to revitalize what we think is a good superhero and good representation of comic book films and some new flavor to the whole vampire genre at the same time.
The vampire nation lies here.
Well, it was much easier than the first one because the vision had been established.
Okay, card print.
Printing.
Check the game.
My first job was convince David Goyer to return as a writer because he actually, at the beginning of this process, didn't want to write the script.
I like to make hybrid movies. It's this strange hybrid of action, science fiction, horror with this comic sensibility. And I knew there were certain things we wanted to do in this film that we hadn't done in the first film, that we wanted to make this film scarier. And I know that's something that Guillermo is incredibly good at. And he knew I was writing Blade 2, and I kept saying to him, when I'm done, we're going to be coming for you, we're going to be coming for you. And he said, yeah, but you know that I want to make it scarier, that's what I do. And we said, we know. We're going to have all the action that we did in the first film, but also this film is very scary.
Excellent. Sucking.
Bite him. Let him go closer to his neck.
And cut. Cut. Does something happen?
Got it.
Did something happen?
We actually came up with the storyline and a first draft pretty quickly. We developed the script independently without a director and then showed it to Guillermo, who had some wonderful additions and subtractions. And you know, he's a very different kind of filmmaker than Norrington. But Guillermo understood what worked in the first movie and was very excited about keeping that kind of baseline and amplifying it in places, and then also bringing what he does.
They came to me the first time, and I read the screenplay, and it was Reapers transforming into everything and tunnels, sewers. And I said, tunnels and sewers and something transforming? I did that movie. I don't want to go through it again. I mean, people are going to think I created the sewers for the second one. They were there from the start. And then I read it the second time, and the idea of the blood pack of the group that joins Blade was much more fun.
I went to the end of the staircase, and then I made a right now.
Don't make a right.
Well, I got to make a right to go up the stairs.
Then when you go higher, sooner,
again,
faster.
Can I show them where it's
supposed to be?
Okay.
Then David and I talked on the phone a little bit on the second time, and I said to him, this is really cool because it's like the Dirty Dozen of vampire. And I asked New Line, for every single piece of film shot by Norrington on the first one, and I went in and I watched, I saw every single piece of raw dailies in that movie. Everyone, all the takes. And then I analyzed the movie. And then I said, this is what I don't want to do with it. This is what I'm going to preserve because I wanted to give it continuity. And after analyzing every single piece of dailies, I knew what the style of the fight was, and I knew how to amp it up one step or two. How to make it the logical evolution of what Norrington had proposed on that one. And I wanted very hard to serve the franchise.
Would it be better if after you put the cylinder, you move first? Uh-huh.
Make you uncomfortable, like go behind your back. Because you're like...
Well, no, that's what I played. I played the doors coming down, all you motherfuckers. I remember I got this shit right here.
Exactly.
Then he turns. The Steadicam will be waiting for him there.
Yes, sir.
He will start coming down, and then Steadicam will push towards him, meet halfway, and we will bring him all the way to the leg. Because he's so active with the hands, if we could, we have Whistler here, blade here. I'll move blade a little bit, cheat the island, and maybe a second camera there just for the sound.
Okay, so third camera for the hand, right? Mm-hmm. So that would be Commander over there for the hands. Mm-hmm. Get the close up there with Tony over at the long length post. Mm-hmm. And the steady cam.
Yes.
No problem.
This is evidently a wonderful expositional scene, and the thing is to try to keep it fluid.
Sure.
He will be basically the one that weaves the whole dialogue.
Roll! Please, rolling!
It's a stretch for Guillermo because he's kind of nodding to where we've been before.
This is Overlord Eli Damaschino.
So he's not throwing it out. He's merely adding his own touches where they're appropriate. Blade himself is a full-born character.
He's a very, very alienated, dark character who's got some scores to settle, you know, within the context of being half-man, half-vampire, and hating suckheads, as he calls them. But it's all deadly serious, and I think that's what kind of sets it apart.
I tend to gravitate towards anti-heroes. I'm doing another project now, Ghost Rider, also a Marvel comic, and I tend to enjoy writing characters that are shades of gray, and I loved all the Clint Eastwood films, The Man with No Name, and I don't regard Blade as being a superhero per se. He's a deeply tortured character. He hates himself, and by extension, he hates the vampires, and I tend to think that those characters, at least for me, are more interesting to write.
They are ready whenever you are, Daywalker.
Blade is a character that sees the world in black and white. I'm not saying it's morally right or wrong, and I think that Blade is that type of character. It's a character that has a very small dramatic arc. Very small. You know, you don't see Blade come out at the end of the movie and say, I shall embrace all forms of life. that's not what that character about, and that's part of the comic book mythology. And I was a fan of the comics he appeared on, but I was not a fan of the Blade character. You know, the Blade character in the comics was very, very boring visually and very predictable. I thought it was like a one-note, jive-talking, like Mod Squad type of character that was just like an African-American written by a white guy that really didn't understand the sensibility except through the Shaft movies he had seen. So I didn't relate to that. I thought Marv Wolfman wrote a great Dracula, but didn't write a great Blade. And when I saw the movie, I was blown away. I was like, oh my God, someone got it. You know, someone, and it was Norrington. Norrington got it, Wesley got it. I mean, I think that having worked with Wesley, I know how much of Wesley is in the first movie, and it's a lot. I mean, Wesley is Blade.
obviously do not know who you are fucking with.
Both Goyer and I have been fans of Guillermo's since Kronos. And we were actually interested in him directing the first Blade.
Which would have been a catastrophe. You know, I think that going from Kronos to Blade 1 would have been like a shock therapy. Because I think that Mimic has more things in common with Kronos in terms of atmosphere and so forth. Kronos to Mimic was a leap. Then Mimic to Devil's Backbone was like going back and finding my personality on certain things with the camera. And then Blade 2 was absolutely 100% just pure fun.
Ready, on, action! Unhook the cylinder, go with the cylinder. Look at her, briefly. Perfect. One more?
And I think that one of the things that I took very seriously doing Blade 2 was, this was, as Devil's Backbone was a chance for me to grow, quote unquote, as an artist, Blade 2 was a chance for me to grow enormously as a craftsman. And I took it in stride as an apprenticeship of really making myself get a whole new set of tools, narratively.
Like it better.
And that's what I went and did in preparation.
No lower.
That's my position?
Yes, no lower than that.
And okay. Then from there, you turn me around?
My syntax is very classic syntax in Devil's Backbone and so forth. It's very classic. Is you know, I respect the axis. I wait for everything to finish, to link it to the next and so forth, make it very fluid. And this is all about compression. This style is all about compression. So I started studying, you know, like I don't know how many times I watched the Eminem videos, which I really like. I mean, I think they're real great pieces of film. And I watched, you know, R.E.M., which I love, Bjork, which I love, things that I could enjoy, you know. And I just realized what type of syntax they had and what type of syntax I liked that they have, because I didn't just absorb it blindly. I said, I don't like this. I don't like what they do here. I don't like what they do there. I'm going to do this other stuff. And I think that, you know, this is a fusion of what I do and what it was required.
Ready? Action!
I think Blade is a very Catholic exercise in modesty, in the sense that I was not there to make Guillermo del Toro's Blade 2. I was there to make Blade 2, the kick-ass movie.
Very good. Print. Got check it. The gate. Gabby? Gabby? Yep. We got it? Yep. Let's go.
I made a lot of notes watching my anime DVDs on what made anime unique and the type of action and violence in anime non-offensive. What is fun violence in anime action? And I made my notes, and I have a diary of ideas and notes that I keep, and I made enough notes in that to start storyboarding stuff before even we scouted locations and to settle down on a style for the movie.
One of the reasons why we came to Prague is because there were so many sets built for this film. It would have been A, too cost prohibitive to do it in the States, but B, the artisans in Eastern Europe are so amazing. I mean, that's one of the reasons you come to Eastern Europe, if you have a movie that has a lot in terms of sets.
I really enjoy the craftsmanship. The craftsmanship that they bring to sets, for example, is very, very old world. You know, the precision and the pride that they bring to their craftsmanship in creating statues, murals, stuff like that, is just really amazing. And it shows in the movie for me. I think that the House of Pain, which contains around 400 extras or so, was another experience of what, to me, the Czech spirit is. I think it was the most amazing, disciplined, giving, adoring, hardworking group of extras that anyone could ever dream of. They were amazing. It was, I was expecting hell, and I got heaven. I mean, it was really, really great.
Here is my lowest. I go up from here. This is good.
And we're going to try and get up for you guys to be able to get in underneath.
Don't you worry about us.
And as soon as he's gone, she comes through. Picture, yes, mate. Yes. Yeah, they're ready. All right, shooting this time, guys. We're going to shoot the rehearsal. So Ron and Matt, we're going to shoot the rehearsal, OK?
Try and reiterate what he said. Try and reiterate.
Was like in the fourth day of shoot, a couple more deodorant sticks would have been very useful. But, you know, other than that, it was great.
Mark and Ron, you have to go in earlier. Earlier.
I can't get under that motherfucker.
When, as soon as you can.
I mean, that thing's like, there's no, like...
I understand, but
I got a 5-second frame right here before it even raises. I can't even get under it.
Okay.
I'm a really boring guy in daily life. I don't like nightlife very much. I enjoy daylight. What I wanted in this House of Pain is to have a place where people can go and drink a human without problem, without being bothered.
The tray of razors.
Okay.
Kiss each other with razor blades on their mouths.
Right.
She's gonna walk here and you're gonna
mutilate each other for fun and leave scars and all that.
Open back massage.
But you need to really be
on this. And then we go up and let her underneath and then go forward.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
And that's, you know, that has no comparison to anything in the real world.
She's to pick it up quicker, right? And these two guys are going to get him up soon.
Earlier.
Yeah.
But more fluid.
Crazy, man.
With a wide angle lens,
yeah.
And you're going to capture the crowd.
Okay.
And do whatever the fuck you want.
So they're good?
Yeah.
This couple here.
Yeah. And you're going to come here. If you were passing, you're going to do it with the three lenses. We're going to repeat the move. I need, Sergio, that we create a wipe here with 6 or 7 people and repeat the move.
Reveal it.
So we're revealing it with different lenses. Boom, boom.
So you just
you
just
start
stack
with
up
that 35. Yeah. You start with the 35, and we'll switch to the 50.
Start tight. Got it. 35 up. Right here.
And, what you need, guys,
one
is just to
well, yeah, we have the same thing. So is it revealed? Well,
you have to put out the tongue a little more.
They were fake, I mean, they were props. They were razor blades with a sharp edge.
Good. Beautiful.
I thought that was a nice image. You know, kind of a very vampiric way to kiss.
Check again.
mean, there was a significant amount in the script in terms of the way the film would look, but also on this film we had the advantage of Peter Frankfurt, the other producer, and I had worked together before, and Guillermo del Toro was a friend of mine, has been a friend of mine for years, and we were both familiar with Carol Spear's work, and so a lot of that, we had hoped Carol Spears would do the production design even when I was in the initial writing stages of the script. So, and I had always hoped that Guillermo del Toro would end up directing it. So we had the advantage of that all being kind of a, you know, happy family.
Carol is exactly part of that family of people you want to work with again and again. And I think that what happens is now she knows the code of things I like so easily. So every time Carol shows me a set, and if I go like here, she goes, I knew it. So here's another alternative. And it's great.
I wrote scenes to a certain extent, especially once Guillermo came on and we were rewriting the script. We wrote scenes towards Carol's strengths, knowing, you know, she was so great at doing this, or expanding certain locations because she was so good. I think she's one of the best production designers in the business.
Aside from the vision that she was able to bring to it, and her ability to translate Guillermo's vision into structure, she was also able to pull off some incredible stuff in a very, very condensed time frame. But she's done an incredible job, you know, we're in the hallway of the House of Pain now. You've seen the actual club. These are huge sets. I mean, and you could live in these things. You know, these things are built to last. It's crazy.
Well, one of the things that surprised me about this film in terms of going from page to reality was just how damn big some of the sets are. The sewer sets in the movie, I mean, you can literally get lost in.
175 feet over there.
You've done a great job.
Not that great, I'd say.
Look down to your left, Ron, to your left. Ha! Perfect, bring and check the gate.
Bring the gate.
Very good. Thank you, Ron. Thank you, Wes. Thank you, Leonard Fita.
They said before they will all start from inside the tunnel. They will all come out chasing Ron that way. All right? Thank you.
Let's go.
Guys, this is picture. Picture's up. Here we go. And sliding in.
Apple 104, take 2, ED for the lock.
Out.
Everything is larger than life because it is a comic book.
There's no one there! Excellent print!
Everything is a little more exaggerated than what it normally would be. And I think that's sort of the unifying thing from set to set. Everything is like gigantic. I get teased a lot from my art department. They say that it's because I'm working in metric here that I'm using, I think of 1 foot, instead of 1 foot, I think of 1 meter, so my sets are all 3 times as large. I think it's because Guillermo wants large sets.
Well, the style is very different from other stuff I've done. This wanted to be like almost gothic, a mixture of gothic and tech. You know, we wanted to have like this rundown industrial feeling for the Eastern Europe that we present. But at the same time, we wanted to evoke what I am attracted to the most, which is gothic architecture.
There's a coffee table book called Dead Tech that is something Guillermo and I were looking at a lot as, you know, we were working on the script. And one of the things that's great about Eastern Europe is there's all these abandoned factories and just, you know, half the country in Prague is that, and you can get them for, you know, amazingly cheap. And they dovetail perfectly into what we're doing with Blade. And one of the things that Carol did so brilliantly is blended pieces that she built in with existing structures. And a lot of times you can't tell which is which.
Well, Gothic to me was the fusion of, since this movie required a different camera style and a different look from the other stuff I've done, I decided to try and integrate a very modern sensibility with a very sort of classic, almost ancient world visuals. You know, we bring some anime, Japanese anime style action into settings that are really much more 17th, 18th century architectural pieces. And those are fused, like for example, the layer of the vampires. It's a very modern building, which is done in like late 20th century architecture style. But at the bottom of it all, as you go through several doors, there is a Roman temple. So it's a fusion of those things that makes it visually very interesting.
I think Guillermo handed me a book called Underground Rome and said, look at this for inspiration.
The whole production design in this movie wanted to evoke very fantastic sets. You know, if it's the Damaskinos cryogenics chamber or the DNA chamber, whatever, it was almost like a James Bond on acid type of set, you know? And if it is Damaskinos' lair, we had Mike Mignola design it or have conceptuals for it to give it a comic book feeling. And there are some images in the movie that are completely like Mike Mignola inspired. They seem right out of the Hellboy comic.
Where we used comic books as reference on the last film on Mimic, because I mean that was a kind of a comic book thing too in another sort of way. Comic books are a very good reference for anybody to look at. Doesn't matter, comic books, video games.
We went into places that that had the corroding walls that had been used to fabricate bombs during the Russian occupation of Prague, and we transformed them a little bit and made them more gothic and made them more ancient world.
Depending on the areas we're in, I mean, Caliban, which is trying to keep it very bunker-like and very sort of cold and. Except for this space, which is Damaskinos, which is the kind of the heart of it. Everything else is kind of very textured or aged.
This movie evokes more like a fantastic underworld, whereas the first one was much more urban. And the palette of colors in Blade 2, the first one had mostly cold colors, like whites, blues, steel. And we went for completely a different hue. We went for amber nights, which are like the nights in Prague, are all done with sodium vapor lights. So we decided to go yellow and amber on the nights and blue days. So it's a very different color palette from the first one.
You know, it's a director's medium. They make it their own. But I think both myself and Gore are in total sync with what Guillermo's doing.
That's what was liberating in Blade 2, first of all, to direct someone else's screenplay, and number two, to be directing someone else's screenplay that we had agreed to not try to make real, but to try to make a comic book, and, you know, it was great.
His basic take on the movie, and I remember sitting with he and Wesley talking about it, the three of us for the first time, and how excited Wesley got and how excited I got, was to keep the movie as exciting and surprising as the first one had been, but to really make it fucking scary. Because really, the first one wasn't scary.
Well, there's two types of horror. I think there's one type of horror which I called hide and seek, which is like in Devil's Backbone or Kronos and so forth, which is more like atmosphere. It's almost like when you're playing hide and seek and you hide in a closet, and the fear of being found out and the fear of not being found out is very ambiguous. And then there is the horror that I call tag, which is playing tag, being chased by someone or something that wants to take you. And that is more the style of the horror in this movie. It's more like a tag movie.
Yes, we have those sort of boo scare moments in this film, but there's just also a number of sequences that are very creepy that have you on the edge of your seat. And that's one of the things that Guillermo is incredibly good at. One of the things we had to do in this film, because we introduced the Reapers, which are kind of the super vampires, is we had to introduce something that even vampires themselves are scared of.
And I wanted to make a variation from the vampire with the pointed teeth, which is a thing we inherited from Lugosi's Dracula, and really has varied very little in the rest of the vampirism history. And in Kronos, I created what I considered a very unique take on vampirism from an intellectual point of view, if you will, you know, from the story and the character and so forth. And I wanted on Blade 2 to take a very unique biological approach.
Was simply the next logical step.
If the romantic vampire in the popular imagination right now is sort of Tom Cruise in Interview with the Vampire, this time I wanted to revert more to the animal. I wanted these vampires to be more like leeches, to be more like just a thing that is there to take your blood and that's it. There's no erotic exchange, there's no subtext. It's just like they just want to drain you. They're not giving you the keys of eternity. They're not giving you nights in the moonlight. They just want to suck you dry. The first design I made of the Reapers, which was the basis of it all, it was just the idea of having a thing have a mouth that occupied almost like half of its face.
Guillermo does a lot of drawings, and I do little sketches as well. And Guillermo and myself, we always had kind of a vision in our heads of what these Reapers would look like.
Well, the Reapers originally on David's were like shape-shifting creatures, meaning they essentially could change into anything in order to get to your blood reservoir, you know? And what I wanted to do is just have them do one single change, but make them organically, internally, completely different from vampires.
These things are as different from us as we are from you.
So I applied what I call the National Geographic approach to design, which is let's try to make it, let's reference exclusively from real life animals. And then by the end of it all, when you go and design, instead of referencing other movies, you're referencing anemone, predators that are like underwater predators and so forth. And when you do that, you end up doing a more realistic design. You know, what would happen if you know, a leech, in its function, is essentially not worried about its features. You cannot see a handsome leech and an ugly leech. They're all just there to do what they do, extract the blood. So I said, if these things were that efficient, then half of their face would really be just a pumping machine. So the design was originally, I started playing with the idea of their face splitting, and then I had the idea of having their mouth expand. And finally we locked into what is in the movie, which is essentially a creature that would keep its feeding apparatus like hidden, protected, until it was time to feed. The first thing I did was do a quick sketch to tell them what I thought the Reaper should look like, more or less. This was quickly outdated by sketches done by far better draftmen than me.
The guy who does a lot of our renderings and our design work, Constantine, we sent him actually over to the office, and he sat there and had discussions with Guillermo for quite a while, and they came up with a look.
This undulates, it latches on, and then you see the bladders move.
It kind of
our hero.
One of the things they kept talking about was very young, hip looking, but then going in with the blood bank scene, kind of hip, edgy, strung out, druggy sort of thing. You know, kind of like that androgynous, thin, bald, you can imagine the body piercing thing. So it needed to be very hip and on the edge. We then did a series of clay maquettes where we sculpt out the Reaper open maw concept. And we would sculpt out in full size and clay every stage of a Reaper open maw, from just the little scar to opening a little bit more, to opening more, to the full pullback. And then bring Guillermo in and have discussions what we want the interior of the maw to look like, how we want all of this stuff to happen.
Once the design was locked, we locked into the approach, how much of it was going to be digital, how much of it was going to be physical.
Jamie! Stand up and look at him! Good, very good, perfect!
And the combination of using physical prosthetics and CG prosthetics.
Action!
We've seen a little bit of it here and there, but I don't think we've ever seen half man, half creature, as a live actor, ever before. I can't think of anything that's like that.
Most people these days go a lot with digital effects and not enough with physical to sell them. I like to blend both.
We've got the Nomac open mouth appliance. Now this one, we've sculpted all the way open. I know there's an issue on teeth. I hope you decide to leave the teeth in. I think it looks better myself. This entire area will be chroma key green. The teeth will be a veneer that goes on top of his lip. So I have an acrylic piece of that goes on top that'll be the teeth, so that we can actually reveal the teeth a little bit and see it makes it a little bit scarier. But all this will be green. Once again, we're gonna sculpt this in relief just in case. You might not have to replace it digitally, but if you don't like it, we'll paint it green or cut it out. But this one is folded all the way back. We're thinking as well, the way this will work is we've got our edge right here. So the idea is we've got Nomac in makeup, and what we'll do is we'll say, okay, let's put him in his folded back mouth appliance. We'll just go, we'll blend this on top of his makeup. It should only take about an hour or so. It'll be pre-painted. And that way we can stick it right on top of his other makeup, and that's how that works.
It's when you get a director like Guillermo who just knows the techniques, and he's not scared to use everything in his whole bag of tricks, you know, and he's not a director who just wants to do CG stuff just because it's the latest, greatest thing, you know. If it's gonna work to use like a sock puppet or something, you know, in the back, he'll do that, and it's great, and he benefits from it, and you come up with a better product.
The CG that they're using for my character particularly, it's just like you think, wow, this is an unbelievable amount of work. And the expense and the kind of just the effort that's gone into these puppets, and the whole kind of behind the scenes thing is fascinating.
The proboscis, which the big tongue, was a little bit of a dilemma as far as, you know, how far does it come out and how graphic should we make it, you know. Basically it's pretty risky.
I remember recently showing some of the footage to some friends, and I hadn't prepared them for what they were going to see. And the women literally were screaming just seeing the raw footage. So I know I can't wait to be in the first preview of this movie and the audience to watch them freak out when it happens. I mean, it's going to be amazing.
And you get sensitized to this stuff. You know, you're working on it, and it's like, God, yeah, but wouldn't it be great, you know, if he just, like, you know, something really bad happened, and then you show it to, like, your parents, and all of a sudden you're painfully aware of how far you've gone, and just like, oh no, I've done it now, you know, and it's hard not to get too carried away with it.
They started off, you know, that there were going to be a lot more puppets than digital effects. There are some puppets in the film, but we ended up replacing more shots than we ever thought. And on set, there were times when we'd try a puppet, and then Guillermo would just say, well, let's just do the maw. And we, at that time, it was a guess that the maw would work.
The puppets were great, you know, and a lot of times there are shots in the film that are just puppets, and that's really cool, but it is a tool. And you'll find the same limitations as you would with just using the computer graphics?
Well, the advantage, obviously, is the mobility without the bulk and the cumbersomeness of cables and cranes and pulleys and dollies and rods and puppeteers. That is obviously the biggest advantage. Now, in terms of operation, also, you can never pack in basically less than a square foot of space as much mechanicals as you need to make it feel completely real. So the CG animated mall allows you for bigger freedom in the movement.
But the one thing that you do benefit with puppets that you really have a hard time with computer is the physicality of the material. So, you know, how it looks. It's an actual thing being photographed right there on the set.
We always wanted to combine them, but we wanted to combine them with very active moths in the move and all that being CG, and the puppets being more stationary and so forth. Ultimately, we mix and match, and we did some of each in both cases. And I think that if you combine techniques, if you use physical and CG, and make the CG as good as you can to make it physical, and make the physical as fluid as you can to make it look like CG, then the eye of the audience goes, how did he do that? And the moment they don't know, they believe. Remember, faith is only hopeful ignorance.
There was a lot of discussions with Guillermo, the director, backwards and forwards as to where we were going to take the look. A little bit of a unique look. Give it some edge. When you have a species that lives for thousands of years, you can draw from any warp of life, any era. There's a little Japanese element, there's a little Hussar element, there's futuristic, I mean, it is all over the map. And that's really great to be able to bring eclectic elements together, that you're not frozen in a time period. And not just eras, but cultures. There's a little native element, there's street kids, really anything goes. And also, because this is Blade 2, carry through some of the feeling from the original Blade, but not make it a Bible. Allow there to be artistic movement.
We started doing basic concepts from my drawings, and then turn them into more elaborate costume designs.
Because it morphed through several different stages, and that probably took about 2 months of sketching. There were many, many sketches that were done that, you know, were never used, where it gave the director an opportunity to see it coming to life and seeing the whole thing becoming a living comic book.
Whoa. Cool, huh?
Since I knew I wanted to do anime or anime-style thing and comic book-style things, I tried to have my notes in my notebook reflect that. So I designed the first approach to the ninja and some ideas for the battle suits for the blood pack.
With the blood pack, because their costumes are all leather and their uniforms were really simple. Rather than going with some really complicated design and piping and, you know, padding and all of that, we made it very, very, very simple and skin tight.
You look smashing.
Thank you.
And the idea was just to make a uniform that would be both practical and very beautiful looking, since these guys would be very vain. They would be like an elite force, and they would like to be shiny and black and really and evoke a little bit of fascist things, because I think Damaskinos is essentially a racist and a purist, you know? And I think that he, like every supremacist, he would like his troops to look really polished.
Blade, this is Overlord Eli Damaskinos. No combination to Marine.
Well, Well, he's 5,000 years old with taste, and there's a definite regal sense of I am king. Again, all very muted, but incredibly rich. He has three main cape outfits. One of them was a beautiful upholstery material that we had to go in color because it was too bright. We literally went in with felt pens and colored it because it wasn't quite the right shade, but it had the right texture, and the patterns and everything were fantastic. One brocade we had handmade in England, where you can have your own, you can pick all your own colors. The other one is an iridescent moire green. It's fuchsia on the inside and green on the outside. And it has Damaskinos seals hand-painted all over it. And that's the one that he walks into the bloodbath in. Scud was really fun because it was the one place where we decided to put a little color. And so Scud's wardrobe was street grunge, but it would have been so easy, again, just to go black. We'd done almost everything in the movie black, but we decided that this would be fun if we sort of tipped him over the scales and just made, you know, like, almost everything he has on is red, you know, right down to his shoes are red. But when you, again, it's all these different shades of red and, you know, shades of distressing. Or where the, just these different levels where some things he's always had for years, and he really does look like this, you know, weeded out hippie, you know, ex-hippie something or other, I don't know.
All right. Bob's got a brand new bag.
Everything was made for the show, with the exception of Whistler. We bought a few things for Whistler and Scud, but every other piece of wardrobe for the main cast was built. So we probably had 120 other outfits or more, because they have so many pieces. I mean, they all have so much of everything because of all the different activities that go on. It's a lot. And then there's a big background scene in the House of Pain where there were 450 extras. That was pretty amazing to get, you know, 450 Czech extras looking like vampires. That was a lot of fun, and they were really great to work with. Blade was established so strongly in the first movie, so to be able to make him a little bit more high-tech, a little bit more conscious of style, everything is just a little better quality. The original style is maintained, but it's enhanced. So we took elements of the design that, because he has this beautiful design tattoo.
He's had a lot more adventures, so every time he has a great adventure, he adds more tattoos to symbolize that adventure.
We took elements and used that, so there was a little bit of embellishment on the wardrobe, but as an insignia more than just design for the sake of design. One of the other things that was really difficult through the whole movie, and particularly with Blade's costume, was dealing with black. Almost all the wardrobe in this movie is black. Between the texture and the light refraction and the shade of black it was, how many shades of black can you make? Well, you could actually make an infinite number. So that all the materials in his clothes, there is a separation between all of the pieces, and it's all the different shades of black. He doesn't look like just a black hole, because sometimes if you have someone in a black wool suit, it is just walking head. From the original movie, there was a sense that he didn't have anything on him that wasn't useful. A very street smart, practical Blade. And the costume originally had a lot of heavy buckles and things like that that were very cool looking and looked like they had some purpose. What we did was we took that same philosophy and stylized it. For example, we actually had those buckles custom made. So they're a unique shape. Also, you can't tell how they close. Actually, it's all magnetized. So it's still utilitarian, but it has a lot of style. And that was sort of carried through with other elements of it too. The materials that we used in his pants look like they're leather, but they're actually this latex-covered lycra, so they're completely flexible so he can fight in them without there being any need for a special pair of pants for him to move into for that. And then because there was a lot of action in the water, we took the finest neoprene fabric, which also has a lot of elasticity to it. When you're standing still, they look really smart. They're really, because you don't, usually with neoprene, it's skin tight. Well, we made it like regular pants, but it had a thermal quality for when he was in the water.
I get so much satisfaction from it.
I mean, when we get into, you know, the more radical elements of the script, then you get to have some fun. Guillermo's having a great time, so it's great to be able to watch the director be a little boy and try and bring to life what a little boy would be fantasizing about. It's really great.
It was a really neat moment when Peter Frankfurt and I, the other producer, first came to Prague, where Wesley had his first costume fitting. And it had been 4 years since he played the character. And he put on the costume this time, and he, you know, buckled up the harness, and he put on the coat, and he drew out the blade. And it had been 4 years since he'd done it, and he drew it out, and it was just Wesley and Peter Frankfurt and the costumer and myself in the room, and he drew out the blade, and he said, looked in the mirror and said, "Oh yeah, I'm back." And it was just such a great moment 4 years later. It was really fun.
And that's what makes it exciting. I mean, that's what we like about Blade.
Get you laid out.
It has not only the whole horror dynamic, it has comedy as well. It looks great. This one is going to look even more beautiful than the first one. And then it has this whole martial arts stylized and sometimes vicious action dynamic, which you don't usually find all of this in one film.
Essentially, two fight choreographers, Donnie Yen, who is one of my most admired martial arts actors and artists from the Hong Kong movies he's done.
Honestly, in the beginning, I didn't expect to be participating in this film. And when Guillermo called me and I met him in LA, and he told me to be this part. And at that time, I wasn't really interested in playing that part because I was more into the choreography of this film rather than the role.
And his stuff is in the movie, and his stuff is a little more whimsical. And actually, we had to tame it down a little bit in how whimsical it was, because Blade's fighting style is not acrobatic. It's more street. It's very violent, very direct and hard-punching.
Blade's system of fighting is kind of whatever works.
He has his own little flavor, you know, and I respect that, and I appreciate that. I actually don't think you should always follow the set pattern of a choreographer or a director.
It's I'm gonna hit you with this, I'm gonna stab you with that, I'm gonna cut you with that.
It's all about the emotion of a character. He could be expressing himself in a very still, emotional way. Or he can express himself in a very physical way.
If I can pick this bottle up over here, I'm gonna bottle you to death.
It all comes from within, so therefore, Wesley, as Blade, he has his own unique character. So every move, punch and kicks, comes from Wesley Snipes playing Blade.
He uses whatever he can, he doesn't care.
By that, by all means, that is originality. So therefore, you know, he should go ahead and continue to maintain that
street style.
That uniqueness.
The second one was Jeff Ward, who was a choreographer on the first movie, and whom I had the tightest collaboration. I really think that Jeff is a genius. I think he is one of the most gifted, inventive, enthusiastic, virtuoso choreographers I've ever met, and his stuff is always original.
Jeff has been with me since Streets of Gold days, and together, he comes up with structure. I come up with some of the crazy, ridiculous stuff, and you know, we put it together, and he can execute it.
We go back as far as 12 years ago, and our friendship, our whole collaboration on films and everything, just we've developed this relationship that carries through on each project.
He's the structure and form to much of what you see is the action dynamic to Blade. And he's a great martial artist as well. And then you throw Clay Fontenot in there, who's my stunt double.
Came into this like raring to go because we had discussed this early on and we started our preparation way before and you know we formulated everything that we really want to try to get across on this. And when it comes to me designing things for him, it's like a 50-50 collaboration on things. I set it up and design it for the things that he can do and the things that he wants to do in terms of the fights.
First of all, introduced a whole new way of looking at martial arts in the West that had a lot of influence from the East, but it had a very urban American take on it. The way the camera was used was to almost very balletic dance around the fights, dance around in a choreographic way with the fights. And we took this to an extreme on the second one because I wanted to through the movie, have every action sequence be different from the one before. And we choreographed the camera in different ways too.
Wesley and I get together to go over the action sequences that are coming up and so that we know that we're not gonna duplicate anything or, you know, just bring it to a different level each time, each battle.
And on top of that, we wanted to do something different than The Matrix or Crouching Tiger. We wanted to go back to more hard-hitting style of action, you know? Because I think people, the moment you see, you know, Cameron Diaz fly in the air and you know she's incapable of flying in the air and kicking five guys, you realize that it's done with wires. And I think that that wire foo style fighting was a little worn down. I mean, Charles Andrews was great, but it was almost satirical. And I think that was kind of the nail in the coffin. So we went for a non-wire foo style of fighting.
Three, two, one, action!
we did some stuff with the L-cam, which means liberated camera, and fusing some digital manipulation of the stuff with the real stunt. And we go with some of the actions to places and following the characters in ways that a normal camera would not do. And the fusion seems very good to me.
I'm ready.
Because our visual effects is like huge and our action sequences are going to be 10 times better than the first one. With our fight sequences that we have coming up, he has multiple attackers coming at him. So things like that where it's an opportunity to really show off the blade sword, but I think we're going to go somewhere else and somewhere completely different. You know, everybody's expecting him to do this thing. So. That's where I have to pull a rabbit out of my hat for some new variety, you know.
Listens to everybody's ideas, the two choreographers, the visual stuff I want to do, and then he does what I call brings the bladeness in.
We call it keeping it funky.
Every time you would say a move, you would for example propose a move. He would say that's not a blade way to do it. What if we do this?
It's got to be funky.
And he would come up with absolutely, really great ideas. And he's a guy that is, aside from everything, he has one thing in common with me. We are both fans. I mean, the guy knows the Donnie Yen movies. The guy knows all the Hong Kong movies.
It's better to work with a director who is a fan of action genres than not, because then you can explain things to him and he'll get it quicker.
You don't have to worry about subtlety. You know, you can just, I mean, it's an element, but you can kind of really have fun playing with timbre and sound and rhythm, and you can make your score bombastic. And from a compositional standpoint, it's a lot of fun because, you know, that's the type of stuff when you're trained some 20th century music and everything. It's really sound exploration. Things that, you know, have been said already by 19th century composers or whatever, and the language isn't that new, but I think there are new ways of approaching stuff, which is, that's why I do this, you know. If I felt like I was doing the same thing all the time, I wouldn't be interested in it. I may as well, you know, lay bricks or something. I usually don't like to work on the movie too early because scripts, you start working from scripts, it's really deceiving. We're not making music for a screenplay. And especially a movie like this, which is so stylized, reading the script, I had no idea the movie would look the way it does. And if I had written the music based on the script, it'd be a different score. Some ideas and themes together, and then I met with Guillermo. He came over to my studio, played him my ideas, and just took off from that. You know, we spotted the movie late, so I just sort of, you know, put music where I thought it should go. It turned out music is like, maybe it's 5 minutes that don't have music in it, but so it was pretty easy to spot in that respect. But you know, I sort of had a sense. I'd worked with Guillermo before. I sort of had a sense of type of emotionally, the type of things that he was going for in the scenes.
It all depends on how the movie does. It will not come out the same time as the soundtrack.
No, it has to come out,
come out 4 or 5 months.
But I mean, I think they pay in 15-minute increments, so maybe at least put 45 minutes of music on.
Yeah. Well, what I told him is that what would be nice is to have an interview as liner notes, an interview with both of us.
Yeah.
You know, where we just discuss, and you know, some of the cues.
How subtle it was?
No. You know what is funny? This is the, like, I remember our first meeting on Mimic.
Yeah.
Nothing that we discussed came through. No, nothing at all.
The only I remember you talking about weirdos.
Yeah, exactly.
You
know,
that you wrote for the as a Mimic sound. Yeah. And then I play it, I remember saying,
what the fuck is that?
Get rid of that.
No, but the thing is, in this case, whatever we discussed came true.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? The combining of coro and orchestral and techno?
Yeah.
It worked. Yeah. So, you know, it's one of those rare occasions where we can be, talking about it.
Yeah. We don't discuss scenes a lot, like the meaning of the scene and what the music needs to do, that kind of stuff. As I mentioned before, like, Guillermo will say, give me some butt willies here or something, you know?
You'll get all the butt willies and all the little things from
it. At 1 o'clock? Yeah. Well, are we going to go out and grab a bite, or should we plan on staying here?
I'm going to go and have a meeting.
Once the concept is there and we have a language together and I play him stuff, it's pretty much a question of, you know, if I can amp something up or get out of the way for this. It's more, comes down to almost more technical.
You would do something more open for the love theme, no?
I can do that now.
Something big.
Something big, I think it's...
No, like not what I mean, minimal. But yeah. Something like, that is also not sappy.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever strings you use should be non-sappy one. Right?
Yeah. I'm thinking the way we should do is, like, everybody play the melodic line slow and harmonics, and strings only.
Yeah, strings only. And get rid of all the woodwinds and brass. Maybe and opening stuff. That chordal stuff. If you get rid of that, then it's just a basic string chart after
that. We should
just
do the melody. Just the melody. I wonder if you could write something quick. Just transcribe.
Just for low strings?
For string
violas and cellos
just
playing?
Just give everybody the melody, and then we can just do it in harmonics, and I'll do it in a slow tempo, like ordinary equals 50. Good. All right? And if we don't
don't do it right now, we'll do it at the end of the day.
Because Julian will have to come
here. Then I can take the second violin part, which has it, and just copy it for a button.
Yeah.
Why don't you do that? Let's do it at the end.
We'll do it at the end.
So which one is named?
We have two more gestures, and then we got, they're all little cues. And we have to do the 3 and 13.
This last one?
I'd like you to be here for 3 and 13. That's the scaffolding fight. Because I'm afraid, the orchestra may have a little too much fun with it.
You think? What do you have?
Like a lot of disco horns and strings.
No, you have horns and strings?
Yeah.
I think horns are not going to work, do you?
Yeah, well, you'll have to hear them when they're used.
What happened? Did you record it or you will?
I ran it through before and I wasn't sure I wanted you to be here.
Yeah.
But I think we should do it after lunch.
Yeah. Do you think the horns are too much of a statement?
I mean, the way they're used now is, I think it might be too fun.
Like too fun to listen to?
Too funky.
Too funky, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. But horns? The horns are doing funky stuff?
Yeah.
No, that's gotta be Batman. You know, the TV series, you know?
Yeah.
Now, do you think that, do you have the strings?
I have strings playing in it.
So, cello or?
Yeah, yeah. What I'll do is,
That will work.
Yeah, we can just test it, pick out the, horn stuff.
And the strings are in long.
It'd be fun to hear it, so I'm really kind of curious.
I'll do it.
But I think it'd probably work.
Let's hear the horns.
I was too timid to do that on my own.
Yeah. No, I'd be afraid about that.
For this stuff.
Of course. For my next film.
This first section, if we could have it much quicker.
Let me look. Hold on. Marco, he's on drugs. Don't listen to him.
What is it?
Marco, But listen to me. Only to me. Don't listen to Bob. He's insane. He has been masturbating for the last 5 minutes in a corner. Whispering your name. What I need, Marco, is just the wooden element that sounds like a spidery element. If you could do a quick rise and fall for when the, for, you know, for like an isolated reaper or the reaper climbing the wall or something, like, you know, a really quick one, up and down.
Are you just talking about the wood block or the strings too?
It was just whatever, just the wood block going, not the strings, whatever the fuck you call that thing that they used to play.
Let's do the whole thing one more time. Before we start, I'd like to get just the opening woodblock stuff.
And Bog has been masturbating, by the way.
Solo. Let's do a little crescendo in the window. Do it a couple times. And then save the tape. We'll bring in the players. Nobody play after the down to 38.
How's the fucked up shit?
All right. You know, here we go. Right?
It's great.
One more active, if you could.
One more, a little more.
Another time, a little longer.
More active.
Yeah, more active.
More active. More active. One more, Marco, please.
One more. More active.
One more is fine.
Mr.
Runmore.
Yeah.
Everyone.
There are many moments in the post-production of a movie where you feel the movie takes a big step. You know, it's a bit like building a house and coming 1 week and you see all the foundation and all that. But when you see the walls up, you go, oh, it's a house. And that happens to me with when I change from hearing a temp, even if it's the temp of the score, to hearing the score itself. I go like, oh, wow, it's a movie. Screen and seeing all the musicians in there. You want me to do it?
Yeah, go ahead. Right.
Is it recording?
Thank you.
How was that?
Yeah. Let's get another one. It was a little loose, and we could pull back on the flutes.
At the end?
Yeah.
Gosh, just innuendo a little bit.
I don't think vampires exist as they are portrayed in the mythology and the lore of movies and novels and literature and so forth. If they do, I apologize. But if I don't think they exist, but I think that it's great. I don't find it terrible that someone just decides to leave that role. And, you know, as long as there's no harm to a third person and they buy their blood properly, you know, it's like, you know, we all live a fantasy. I mean, I think I am a director, you know. So what's the difference between me thinking that or being a vampire? It's an exactly, it's probably more elaborate a paranoid fantasy to be a director than to be a vampire. So, you know, God bless you all and enjoy it. Enjoy it while it's legal. I suspect, in my personal theory, like an anthropologist with a pipe, you know, I suspect this is the way we deal with cannibalism. I mean, I think that there was a time where we must have eaten each other. And the way you deal with it is through mythology. I mean, the way people dealt with the sun rising and falling was mythology. With rain falling or not was mythology. So the way you deal with a past as terrible as that as humanity, as a genre, is by inventing a myth. But I think that vampirism is part of that impulse, the animal impulse of the animal, the man-animal, if you want, like a wolf would eat a wolf, probably, if not an intellectual creature, man would probably eat a man. And the way you deal with those impulses is create a nice, scary story to go with them.